sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. And sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
That you on this 4th of July weekend, and just to take a moment to pray for our country and to thank God that He allows us to live in this great nation. And I just want to take a minute to recognize those of you who have served our country. So if you'll do this, you'll do this for me, I just really appreciate it. If you have served or are serving, if you're a veteran or you are presently serving in our United States Coast Guard, would you stand and just stay standing for me? All right, thank you. Stay standing if you don't mind. If you are serving or have served in our United States Navy, would you please stand and stay standing? All right. If you are, just stay standing if you don't mind. If you are serving or have served in our United States Marines, would you stand and stay standing? All right. If you are serving or have served in our United States Air Force, would you stand and stay standing, please? All right. If you are serving or have served in our United States Army, would you stand and stay standing, please? All right. We just want to say thank you for your service. We appreciate you very much. You can have a seat. You can have a seat. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for today and for the opportunity to be together to worship, to lift up the name of Jesus. And Father, I thank you that in your grace, you have allowed this nation that we live in to prosper for so many years. And Father, I know that we can find lots of reasons to complain about things we don't like about our country. I get that. But Father, we have lots of reasons to be very thankful that in your sovereign grace, you've allowed us to live in this great land. And Father, to think about people like those who stood before us, I think about in this service, I think about our early service, the men and women that stood in that service who have served or are presently serving in our armed forces. Father, these people that we have seen standing before us this morning, they have given a large part of their lives to serve this nation, and we're thankful for that. I know that we have many in this faith family who serve our armed forces, who've been deployed in different parts of the world. We've seen families come to our church for just a season of time before they're sent off somewhere else. And so, Father, I know that every one of these families that are serving or have served, they've just lived a different kind of life, and they've done that sacrificially, and they've done that for the sake of this country to preserve the freedoms that we enjoy and even take for granted every single day. And so, Father, these people are honorable and they are worthy of our honor. And so I thank you for these men and women and how they have served our country. And Father, we do want to pray for this nation. Father, it seems like every single day we're inundated with division and divisive speech and all kinds of stuff. But Father, we want to keep in mind that you have a plan for this nation. You have a plan for your church in this nation. And so Father, in this country, we have the opportunity, even today, to come to a place like this and worship without fear of the authorities coming in and shutting us down. That's a privilege that in other nations, they don't share that privilege. And so we thank you for that privilege. And we thank you that we have the privilege of being able to speak the gospel, that we don't have to worry about being told to be silent and in different places. We can openly proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. We thank you for that, the religious freedom that we've enjoyed over so many years. Father, help us to endure and fight to preserve those freedoms and help us to give thanks for those freedoms. Father, we do want to lift up our elected officials. We think about our president and cabinet and our Congress and our state and local elected leaders. Father, give them wisdom because they need it. Give them just the wisdom from you to know how to lead our nation well. Father, I pray that ultimately what would happen in this country, we would see your church rise up and boldly share the truth of Jesus Christ, that we might see, Father, a move of your spirit sweep across this land. That's what we need, Lord. But I do thank you this morning that we are able to experience just the great freedoms that this country affords to us. And Father, I thank you most of all for the freedom that we have found in Jesus Christ. Christ. He has set us free from sin and death. And Father, we are part of an eternal kingdom, a kingdom that will last forever, a kingdom where there is peace and righteousness and joy. And so thank you, Jesus, for giving us freedom through your life and death and resurrection. We love you this morning. We honor you. We worship you in Jesus' name. Amen. Go ahead and stand back up and let's continue to worship together.
Song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. Lord is my salvation. I will not fear when darkness falls. His strength will help me scale these walls.
right, let me invite you to take your Bible and open up to the book of Psalms. We are continuing our journey through this amazing book of the Bible, and we are this morning in perhaps the most famous psalm, perhaps one of the most famous passages of Scripture in all the Bible, one of the most beloved passages of Scripture in all the Bible, and rightly so, we're in Psalm 23. I think this morning we were to go downtown and wake up the guy who drank a little much last night sleeping on the park bench, and you asked him, hey, do you know Psalm 23? He'd probably get a line in off of it. He probably knows a little bit of it, right? Because it seems like everybody has some familiarity with Psalm 23. For many of us, we might remember this psalm being read at funerals and things like that, and certainly you can understand why. It's a psalm of much comfort, but this is a psalm that is full of life and hope. So Psalm 23 is where we are this morning. If you didn't bring a Bible, that's okay, because in the seat before you down the book rack, you'll find a copy of the Bible. Pick that Bible up and find Psalm 23 with us. If you don't own a Bible, take that Bible home with you and read it and learn about the God who loves you and desires a relationship with you. Psalm 23 is where we're going to spend our time together this morning. I think most of you know, unless you're a guest with us, most of you know that I have two kids. My oldest son, Luke, he will be 12 in October, which is hard to believe. When we moved here, you know, 5 years ago, he was in kindergarten. Now he's going to middle school. I don't even know how that happened, but he's going to be going into middle school this year. And in Hudson, he will be 8 years old next month in August. And so, man, it's just amazing to watch them grow up and see what God's doing in their lives. And so one of the things that my boys enjoy, perhaps more than anything else, is they really enjoy sports. Like if you give them a ball, they're happy. They play wiffle ball in the backyard. They play football with the kids across the street. They play basketball in the front yard. They've played rec ball. Luke's now playing school basketball. They just love sports. And I like sports too. I like to watch sports. We like to watch the Braves together, or obviously the Bulldogs together, or whatever season it is. We enjoy watching sports, right? And so we played rec baseball this last year up in Monk's Corner. They both had really good seasons. They're growing in their understanding of the game and the fundamentals and the skills that you need to be a good ball player. And so Luke, this, or not Luke, Hudson, this past year, he wanted to play a certain position. And so he got the opportunity to play the position that he wanted to play. He got to play catcher. I got a picture of him playing a catcher. I mean, yeah, there's not a catcher gear that will fit him, but he gave it a good try and he did well. He learned how to squat behind the batter's box there and catch the ball, all that kind of stuff. And so I don't remember when it was, but we were coming home from a baseball game or something along the way, and we were talking about life, and Hudson said, Dad, when I grow up, I want to be a Major League Baseball player for the Atlanta Braves, which makes sense because we're big Braves fans, and so he wants to be a Major League Baseball player for the Atlanta Braves, to which I said to him, buddy, that's great, but it's probably not going to happen. I mean, I'm that kind of parent that just wants to shoot straight with my kids. I mean, he's good and all that, but you know how it is. It's like one in a million, right? I don't want to give my kids false expectations of all that kind of stuff. And so I'm just like, let's just play the odds, buddy. It probably ain't going to happen for you, you know? And he didn't speak to me the rest of the day. I mean, it was really bad. And so from that point on, my kids have kind of called me Dad the Dream Crusher. Yeah, right? Because let's just be honest, what every kid wants, what every child wants, is a parent who says what? I believe in you. You can accomplish your dreams and your goals. Every kid wants that parent who will come alongside of them and support their dreams, right? In fact, I would say for you, as an adult, here's what you want in life. And this is just a basic human need that all of us have in life. We all want someone who will come alongside of us and say, you can make it. You can do it. You can be, right? Not only do we want someone who will come alongside of us and encourage us, we want someone who will come alongside of us and also show us the way. I will show you how to get there. I know that we're celebrating Independence Day tomorrow, and I know that we are a people who pride ourselves in independence, and in your own life, you want to be independent, you want to be self-sufficient and all those kinds of things, but let's just be honest. You have a deep, innate desire to be led. You want someone to show you the way. That sounds like a song, doesn't it? You want someone to show you the way. None of you got that, but that's okay. You want somebody to show you the way and help you down the path of life. Here's the beauty of Psalm 23. Psalm 23 is a reminder that there is one who desires to lead you, who desires to lead you to accomplish his goal for your life. There's one who desires to lead you to become who he wants you to be. There's one who desires to lead you to a truly blessed and prosperous life. This psalm, you know it, is about God, our shepherd, who desires to lead us. It is a beautiful psalm with very encouraging words. And I think as we look at this psalm this morning, this is going to help us to be a people who learn how to follow the leadership of our Heavenly Father even better. And so what I want to do this morning, as we walk through Psalm 23 together, I want to show you three truths in this passage of scripture, three truths in Psalm 23 that I think will help us as God's people hear his voice and follow him wholeheartedly. So take your Bibles, Psalm 23. If you have that passage, go ahead and rise to your feet as we honor the ring of God's word together. Psalm 23. Listen to what the Bible says. The Lord is my shepherd. I have what I need. He lets me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He renews my life. He leads me along the right path for his name's sake. Even when I go through the darkest valley, I fear no danger, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Only goodness and faithful love will pursue me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord as long as I live. Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for time to be together in your word. I thank you, Father, that you are a good shepherd that leads your people well. Father, I pray that as we study this very familiar psalm this morning, that you would teach us how to hear your voice and how to follow you by faith and in obedience to your will. Father, we trust now that you're speaking to us, and as you speak, we want to be a people who listen carefully to your voice and respond to your voice in faith and obedience. In Jesus' name, amen. You can have a seat. Now, if you've been around, you know that we've been walking through the Psalms together for several weeks. And last week we were in Psalm 22. And if you think about Psalm 22 and you think about Psalm 23, obviously they're a bit different. Psalm 22, David is in deep despair, and he writes some of the most gut-wrenching words in the Bible. My God, why have you forsaken me? I mean, those are gut-wrenching, heart-turning words. But now here we are in Psalm 23, and it opens, doesn't it? It opens quite a bit differently than Psalm 22. Now a lot of Bible scholars believe that Psalm 22, Psalm 23, Psalm 24, they are connected, and they were written around the same time. And I know when you think about Psalm 23 and you have this imagery of a shepherd, you probably think about David when he was a shepherd, and maybe as a young boy, you know, out in the in the night sky, watching the stars as he cared for his flock, and you think about him laying on his back, looking at the stars, and hearing the sheep close by. And so I think that it's probably more likely that David did not write this psalm as a young shepherd boy, but wrote this psalm as an older man after he's been through it. After he's been through the good times and the bad times and everything in between, after he's had those moments of despair where he has said things like, my God, why have you forsaken me? He knows God has not forsaken him. And this psalm, he says, Lord, you're my shepherd. He thinks about what a shepherd would have done in those days because he did it. How a shepherd literally spent most of their time with those sheep. And when I think about shepherd, because I've been to Israel quite a few times now, I think about that Judean wilderness. I brought a picture I took in Israel a couple years ago, and you can see it. You can see this big flock of sheep. I know it's not very good picture, but you can see them down here, and you can see the couple shepherds there, and you can see all the mountains and the rocky terrain, and that shepherd committing his life to leading those sheep to find somewhere in all that desert region some fresh water. finding some grass to feed on, and just that commitment, and knowing, and you probably know this because you've heard a preacher like me maybe talk about sheep and shepherds before, that sheep, whether it's deserved or not, they have a reputation of not being very smart, right? A sheep, they're not very selfless. I mean, they're animals, and so animals think about themselves and how to feast and how to survive, and they're not very self-sufficient. You probably know this about sheep, that the reason why they travel in flocks is because they just can't take care of themselves. They can't defend themselves very well against predators, and so you have a shepherd who will give his life to take care of his sheep, and the question is why? Why would a shepherd spend so much time caring for the sheep? Why not find another occupation? Why not do something else? Why choose to be a shepherd? And it's a very simple answer, because sheep in those days were extremely valuable, right? They were valued because of their wool. They were valued because of their meat. They were valued because they were sacrificial animals. And so if you had a flock of sheep, if you owned sheep, you had treasure. And now you think about the Bible, and Psalm 23 isn't the only place where God is referred to as a shepherd. We find this in other places in the Bible as well. You know that ultimately in John 10:10, Jesus says, "I am the good shepherd." And this good shepherd, the God of all creation, this one who is our shepherd, he values his sheep. You are valuable in the eyes of God. God loves you. He knows everything about you. He has destined your steps. He knows the work he wants to do in your life for his glory and your good. You are valuable in God's eyes. Now, as David is older in life and reflects back over the course of his life, he's learning. He's learning that God is that good shepherd who knows how to lead him. God is that good shepherd that values David's life. And David has seen this over and over again. And so now, maybe as an older man, he writes these words, "The Lord is my shepherd. I what? I shall not want." Or in my translation, "I have what I need." He knows it. And you think about David at this point, if he does write this psalm when he's older in life, he's got a lot of stuff. I mean, he's king, and it's good to be king. He has wealth, and he has, you know, horses and chariots and all these different things. But he reflects on his relationship with God, and he says, "In God, I have what I need." And he goes on to say what? "He lets me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters." You have this imagery, do you not, of sheep that are safe, that are secure, that are at peace, that are resting. And when I read these words in Psalm 23, my brain can't help but go back to the Garden of Eden. This is the way it's supposed to be. That in the presence of God, there's what? There's peace, there's security, there's rest. It's what Adam and Eve had. Before they fell into sin, this is what Adam and Eve had. Now, as David follows the leadership of his shepherd, God Almighty, he gets to experience some of that. That peace that comes and knowing the presence of God at work in your life. And he goes on to say things like this. Listen, "He renews my life. He leads me along the right path for his name's sake." Because you know this like I do, that sheep are what? They are prone to wander. And you are too. You've been there. David certainly was there. We have this proclivity to follow our sinful desires. David had done it over and over again. You've done it too. But aren't you thankful that you have a good shepherd, right, who knows how to renew your life, that when you wander, God is able to bring you back into his fold? This is what David's talking about. I don't have any needs. He knows how to provide my needs. He knows how to lead me to rest. He knows how to bring me back into the fold for his namesake. And so here he is. David is later in life. David's reflecting back over the course of his life. And I just want you to see this first truth from this passage. The more you walk with with God, the more confident you become in God's leadership. This is what has happened in David's life. He's walked with God over the years, and as he has walked with God, he has come to learn that he can trust that God knows what he's doing in his life. And across this room, I'm looking at people sitting in these chairs this morning. There are many of us that have followed God for years. Some of you in this room, you've been Christians for 30, 40 years, some 10, 15, 20. And I bet you if we were to go around the room and do a survey this morning, here's what you would say. If you follow the Lord for any length of time, you would probably say what? I have learned that I can trust God. I have learned that he knows what he's doing. I have learned by walking with him that I can have confidence that he knows how to lead me well. Right? Now think about this, because you think about this, go to the next slide if you don't mind. Embrace what you have been given in Christ instead of longing for what the world tells you that you need, because you live in a world that's telling you, you don't need God. You need what? You need wealth. You need power. You need sex. You need prestige. You need this. You need that. No. I've learned something different. By following the shepherd, by following God over the course of years, I've learned that I don't need all this stuff the world tells me I need. I have learned to embrace what I've been given in Christ. I have learned that in Christ, I have all that I need. And so for us, it really is on a regular basis, stopping and asking ourselves the question, whose voice am I listening to? Am I listening to the voice of this world that's constantly telling me, here's what you need? Or am I listening to the voice of God who has told me and shown me I have all that you need? You see, the more you walk with God, the more you learn. You can follow him. The more you learn, you can have confidence in his leadership. The more you learn, he has all that you need, right? Or think about this. Embrace God's leadership comprehensively instead of selectively choosing how you will be led. You think about the heart of David here, right? What David is saying, he's saying, the Lord is my shepherd. My shepherd knows how to lead me in every area of my life. Because here's what happens, and you know this just like I do. What we tend to do in our Christian walk is we tend to treat God like a buffet. I don't know how many of you like buffets, but you know how a buffet works. You pick what you want, and you eat as much as you can eat, right? Stacy won't let us go to the Golden Corral. My boys are deprived, right? They've never been to the Golden Corral. I don't think Stacy will ever let us go to the Golden Corral. But I remember going to the Golden Corral as a kid. It's amazing. I mean, all the food you can eat. There's that chocolate fountain that every kid stuck their hand in. I mean, who doesn't want that, right? But the idea of a buffet is what? You pick and choose. You pick and choose. I'm going to select the steak, but I'm not going to select this. I'm going to select this, but not select this. Some of us approach our faith that way, don't we? With God, it's pick and choose. God, I want you to lead me in this area. Here's where I need the help. I need the help in my marriage. It'd be really, really nice, God, if you'd give me some wisdom here, if you'd make this better, because we're having some struggles. I need you to lead me in my marriage. But my finances, hands off, God. I got that one figured out. God, I need some help on my job. I don't know how I'm going to make it through my career because everybody seems to be against me and all these other kind of things. I need your help here. Would you please help me here? But over here, this area, I'd like for you to leave that alone. And so what we do is we pick and choose. God, help me here, but I don't need your help here. God, put your hands on this, but take your hands off of this. You see what I'm saying? It's selective. We want God to be our shepherd in certain areas of our life. And so for you this morning, it may be that what you need to do is just stop and ask yourself the question, where am I being selective in my walk with the Lord? Where am I saying to God, God, lead me here, but hands off of this? You see what I'm saying? And it may be you need to turn around around and have a conversation with your spouse at some point and ask your spouse what he or she sees in you. Does your spouse see you following Jesus in every area of your life or picking and choosing how you want to follow God? You see, because what Jesus said to us in Luke 9:23 is that if you want to come after him, what do? You take up your cross, you deny yourself and follow him. No, the call to discipleship is not a call to a buffet where you pick and choose how you want God to work in your life. No, it's everything. God, I give you my everything. Lead me in every area of your life. And the more you walk with God, the more you become convinced that God is more than able to lead you well in every area of your life. You follow? I don't know if you know this or not, or if you saw this on the news this week, but there was this guy who wanted to work at the happiest place on earth. He wanted to work at Disney World. Now, I don't know if Disney World is the happiest place on earth. I've never been there, but some of you have, and you can talk to me about it later, I'm sure. But he wanted to work at Disney World. And so he put in a job application and all those kinds of things, and then he had an idea. He dressed up as a Disney employee. Put on his khakis, his shirt, the orange vest, like he was an employee there. And he went to Disney posing as an employee. He was pulling around a cart with him. And then he went into one of the buildings. I don't know what building it was. And he started to take stuff. He ended up stealing a replica of R2-D2. Because who doesn't want a replica of R2-D2? And so he gets this replica of R2-D2 worth $10,000. And he puts it in his cart, and he's making his way out of the Disney World park with his replica of R2-D2 and some other things that he stole, wearing his vest, looking like a Disney employee. And he got found out. And so here we are this morning, sitting in this room, worshiping Jesus, learning from his word. And this man, this morning, he's sitting in a prison cell because he stole some stuff from Disney. And so then he was asked the question, why'd you do it? Because that's always the question you want to know. Why'd you dress up like a Disney employee and go and steal R2-D2? Here was the answer. He had applied for a job in security. He wanted to show Disney World the flaws in their security system. So he thought, maybe I can show them the flaws in their security system, I'll get the job. And so he went and stole R2-D2, and apparently they didn't have many flaws because he got arrested, right? And so he did not get the job. But I bet you, and I don't know this for sure because I don't know the man, haven't talked to him or anything, but I bet you this morning he is sitting in a prison cell thinking, that wasn't a good idea. How did it work out like I thought it would work out? And I'll tell you that story to tell you this. You're going to get to a point in your life, if you haven't gotten there already, and you're going to look at some of the choices you make, and you're going to say, that wasn't a good idea. That didn't work out the way I thought it would work out. And you're going to say something like this: I should have listened to what God said to me. I'm in church. I'm studying his word. I'm in a discipleship group. I'm hearing all this truth. I should have actually put it to practice. Maybe God does know what he's talking about. You see what I'm saying? What we'd like to do, we'd like to pick and choose. I'll follow here, but I won't follow here. When God is saying to us, listen to me. Listen to me. Now, we're all going to make mistakes. We're all going to sin. But the more you follow Jesus, the more you're going to make those wise choices. And the less you're going to say, man, I shouldn't have done that. Because you're going to learn to hear the voice of your shepherd and walk by faith in every area of your life. But David's not done. You know what he goes on to say. Look at what he says. He describes the role of the shepherd in his life. And then he comes down in this famous verse, even verse 4, even when I go through the darkest valley, I fear no danger, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. That's good, because you've been there. You've been in the dark valley. I think about my trips to Israel. I think about going into that wilderness area of Judea. I think about the Dead Sea area and seeing all those mountains and all the nooks and crannies and the caves and all those kinds of things. And think about how a shepherd would lead their sheep through those kinds of areas to try to bring that sheep to the other side of that dark valley to ultimately feed that sheep and bring that sheep to some fresh water. Those dark valleys. David knew what a dark valley was. He'd been through some dark valleys. Enemies pursuing him. Family members turning on him. Losing loved ones. He'd been through dark valleys. Now think about where you are this morning in this room. There are some of you here, you're in a dark valley. The circumstances of your life aren't what you want them to be right now. Some of you are grieving loss. Some of you lost a job. Some of you are in some marriages that aren't working out right now. Or whatever the case may be, you feel like this morning that you're in that dark valley. And what happens when you're in the dark valley is you tend to do what? You tend to fear. God, where are you? Psalm 22, my God, why have you abandoned me? God, what are you doing? Can I trust you? Is it worth it in this dark valley to obey you? And so in those dark valleys, there's a tendency, is there not, to question God and to wonder if we can really trust his leadership. But what David says is this, right? When I go through the dark valley, I will not fear danger. Why? Because you are with me. That in that dark valley, God has not left you. In that dark valley, God is not absent. In that dark valley, God is present with his people. He is close to you in that dark valley. You think about this. Some of us find ourselves this morning in dark valleys because of the circumstances of life. It's a hard season. But have you ever thought about this? Listen. You ever thought about this? Sometimes God will call you to go into the dark valley. You ever thought about that? Sometimes God will call you to take a step of faith, and when you take that step of faith, it might look like a dark valley to you. It could be that God is calling you to a place that you're just uncomfortable going to, and it seems like a dark valley. It could be it's just a walk across the street to get to know your neighbor and ultimately share the gospel with your neighbor. And you say something like this, it's a dark valley. I can't do that. It's too hard. Or you think about something else. It might be that call maybe to take that short-term mission trip or whatever else it might be. And you say, God, that's too hard for me. That looks like a dark valley to me. That's a challenge. I can't do that. Or you think about something else, right? Maybe it's a call on your life to minister to people that aren't anything like you. It's that person that you want to have nothing to do with. And God's saying, that's exactly the person I want you to minister to. And you say, God, I don't know about that because that's a dark valley to me. And so sometimes what will happen in your faith is God will call you to step into what looks like to you a dark valley. And here's what I know about those dark valleys of ministry. It's in those dark valleys that God wants to use you and that God wants you to minister. And that ultimately God wants to remind you that he's with you even there, right? And so for you right now, here's the question you need to ask. Where is it? Where is it that God is telling me to go? What is it that God is calling me to do that from my perspective looks like a dark valley? And so I'm refusing. I'm resisting because right now my life is too comfortable where I am. And so I don't want to step in that direction. You see, because here's what I know. Watch. The more you walk with God, the more you are willing to follow God in the hard places. The more you walk with God over the years, the more that dark valley doesn't seem so dark because you know God is there. It might be hard. It might be challenging. It might be full of obstacles, but you know that God is with you and you don't have to fear it. So therefore, think about this. You should fear staying in the easy place where you are, resisting God's will, more than you fear going into the hard place where you know God is calling you. That makes sense to you? What you might need to fear is you staying in your own comfort because God isn't calling you to stay in your own comforts. He's calling you to take that step of faith. And so you need to fear that desire to stay in your comfort zone more than you fear saying yes to God and walking in that hard place. And think about this as well. You are missing out on real blessings when you fear the valley and resist the leadership of the shepherd. There's blessing in that valley. Because that valley where God is calling you to, that valley that God is bringing you through, that valley may very well be the place that God uses to grow you, to strengthen you, and to use you in ways that you have not been used before. You see what I'm saying? The more you walk with God, the more you're willing to walk through the valley because you know what God does in the valley. And so I just want to ask you, I know there are some of us in this room, we find ourselves in that dark valley because of life circumstances, the loss of a loved one, the loss of a job, or whatever the case may be, God is with you. There's some of us who are avoiding the valley. That God is calling you to something and it looks like to you, oh, I can't do that because it's a dark valley. And this morning you need to say, okay, God, yes. It's a challenge, it's not comfortable, but following you is more important than me trying to stay comfortable where I am. I don't know if you saw this or not on the news this week. Some of you fly Delta quite a bit, but you see this? It's a terrible time to fly. Some of you know that because you've tried it and it didn't work out for you this summer. And so they had overbooked a flight, and I don't remember where the flight was, but they had overbooked a flight, and so they offered 8 people $10,000 to get off the plane. I'm thinking about after church just going and buying airline tickets and camping out at the airport and just, you know, play the lottery, right? I mean, if that was me, if I was on that flight, I would have run off that plane. Give me the $10,000. I'll stay in this airport for a week. I don't care. I'll sleep in the bathroom for a week. I don't care. Give me the $10,000, right? I mean, can you imagine $10,000 to get off the plane? Oh, I'd have taken them up on that offer, right? Because here's what happens. Here's what happens. When I'm inconvenienced, you know what I expect? I expect immediate payment for my inconvenience. When I'm inconvenienced, I expect for someone to what? To do me right immediately. Instant gratification. If somebody does me wrong, I expect you to make it right immediately. I expect instant payment for inconvenience. Now let me tell you where I'm going with this. That's how we approach God sometimes. God, to go to that hard place, it would sure be an inconvenience for me. So I'm going to step by faith into that hard place. You better make it worth my time. If I'm going to step by faith into that place of difficulty that you're calling me to, you better make it worth my time immediately. But that's not always how God works. You think of people like Adoniram Judson. You remember that name, Adoniram Judson? He was a missionary from America to Burma years ago, back in the 1800s. And he went to Burma with his wife, and they had children there. And he lost his wife. She died. 3 of his children died. He stepped into a place of inconvenience, and God did not give him an instant payment. Instead, he lost his wife and 3 children. He was in prison twice while he was there. He was there for years, and it took years for him to begin to see people come to faith in Jesus Christ. But his influence over the course of a lifetime in Burma is still felt today because he was used by God to translate the Bible into their language, you see? But there was no instant payoff for him in Burma. No, he labored and labored and labored and did not get the payoff. Now watch this. He did not get the payoff until when? Until he stepped into eternity. But I think, my friend, if you and I were to step into eternity today and we were to find Adoniram Judson and have a conversation with him in eternity, he'd probably say what? It was worth it, right? Because it's always worth it to step out in faith. Even if it looks like a dark valley to you, it's always worth it because God knows what he's doing. And it's always worth it because God knows what he's going to do in your life and through your life. And you might not get that instant payoff, but I promise you, as you walk by faith, oh my friend, God rewards those who walk by faith forever. And so therefore, longer I walk with God, the more willing I am to go in those hard places because I know that God is there as well. Now, we got to end our time together, but let me show you how David ends this wonderful psalm. So if you think about it, verses 1-4, that David is talking about the shepherd, that God is this great shepherd who knows how to lead David in the good times and the bad times. And David experienced both. But you come to the end, and the metaphor, I don't know if you know this or not, the metaphor shifts. The first 4 verses, he talks about God as a shepherd. Now in verses 5 and 6, he talks about God as his what? His host. Going to God's house and God feeding him a meal. And when I read these verses, I can't help but think about the book of Revelation. And how in Revelation, we're reminded that there will come a day when we step into eternity and Christ returns for his people and we're with him once and for all, that there is going to be a supper of the Lamb, right? That God is our host. And look at what he says. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Only goodness and faithful love will pursue me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Do you see what David's saying? David has gone through the valley. He's gone through the dark times. He's had his enemies pursue him. But at the end of the day, what has David seen? David has seen God lift him up. You follow? And David has seen that God, even when his enemies were pursuing him, that God was loyal to him. And so David says, God, it's like you're a great host. You've invited me into your house to dwell with you. You've allowed me to feast on you. You've anointed my head with oil. You've lifted me up. Goodness and mercy follow me all the days. Think about that. David knew what it meant to be pursued. It seems like when you read through the book of 1 Samuel, for example, that David's always on the run. But when David looks back and he thinks about all the times he's been pursued, what does he say? God, your faithful love and your goodness have followed me all the days of my life. And here's why I know, church. Come on in real close. Listen to me. Come on, listen. I know that you feel like you've been pursued by lots of different stuff in this life. You've been pursued by financial troubles. You've been pursued by heartache. You've been pursued by grief. You've been pursued by loss. You've been pursued by all kinds of troubles in this world. But when you look back over the course of your life, I hope you see this, that God has pursued you every single day of your life with faithful love and goodness. Isn't that good? I know you feel like you're pursued by everything else. But the reality is, every single moment of your life, with faithful love and goodness, God is pursuing you. And so just think about this as we get ready to finish our time together. The more you walk with God, the more you see God's plan unfold. And you're seeing that. David saw that as he walked with God, he saw God lift him up, right? And essentially what David is saying is this, and you know this to be true in your own life. I follow God. He's a good shepherd. And this good shepherd knows how to bring me safely home in his presence. And God knows how to do that in your life too. He knows how to pursue you. He knows how to bring you safely home into his presence. So think about this. Think about this. You will not look back over your life and say, God didn't bless me. Listen, I've been at this for a while. And I've been by the bedsides of a lot of people before they step into eternity. And I've never heard a follower of Jesus say, before that follower of Jesus stepped into eternity, God didn't bless me. Never once. And I've sat by the bedside of people who are stepping into eternity who had hard, tough lives. But I've never once heard anyone say, God didn't bless me. Instead, I've heard what? Over and over again, God has been good to me. Because you know it. You know it, that in the midst of all the craziness that this life throws at you, that the faithful love and goodness of the Father has pursued you all the days of your life. When I think about this psalm, I can't help but think about King Jesus. Now, we saw this last week in Psalm 22. In Psalm 22, we said, man, that was a prophetic psalm. It points us right to the cross. Well, so does Psalm 23, if you think about it. Because Jesus is the one who did what? Stepped into this world as a lamb, a sheep, a sacrificial lamb, right? And Jesus is the one who walked through the darkest valley. You think about being rejected by people and on the Via della Rosa to his crucifixion. And that dark valley that Jesus walked through, you know where it led? It led to a cross. It didn't lead to a green pasture. It didn't lead to quiet waters. It led to a brutal crucifixion on a Roman cross, where Jesus suffered the punishment that you deserve for your sins, where he suffered the death that you deserve, where he experienced the wrath of God that you deserve. Jesus went to the cross as a sacrificial lamb to pay the debt that you owed, to die in your place, to take your sins upon himself so that all of your sins can be forgiven. And this one who went as a sacrificial lamb to the cross, who was crucified in your place, 3 days later, rose from the dead, victorious. And you think about what the psalmist says. You think about what the psalmist said. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Christ exalted. Christ raised from the dead. Oh, the enemies see it. Satan and his satanic forces see it, right? Christ is victorious. Christ is there with the Father. The Father is loyal to his Son. The Father has brought Jesus safely home. And now this one who is the sacrificial lamb, he is at the right hand of the Father, not only as our sacrificial lamb, he is there as a conquering lion who has defeated sin and death for us, who will one day come back for his people, and he will bring us into his Father's house, and we will live with him in his Father's house forever. Do you see? Psalm 23 points us to Jesus Christ, our sacrificial lamb, our conquering lion, who now also, now watch this, John 10:10, this one who was our lamb is also our what, church? Our shepherd. Jesus Christ knows how to lead you. So my friend, I know this is a familiar psalm. As we end our time together, I just want to ask you a couple questions. One, if you're a follower of Jesus this morning, are you following the leadership of your shepherd? I know that's a simple question, but think about it. This morning, some of you are selective in the way that you follow Jesus. I want your help here, God, but I'm all right here. And this morning, for some of us, what we need to do is just confess that. God, forgive me. I need to follow you in every area of my life because you know what you're doing. Or think about this. Some of you know that hard place that God is calling you to, and you're resisting. And today is the day for you, follower of Jesus, where you say to the Father, wherever you lead, I'll go. Because I know that you're with me in the hard place, and I know that in that hard place that you might be calling me, that you're gonna use me, and that you're gonna grow me, and so I'm gonna follow you in the hard place. And so maybe for some of us in this room who are followers of Jesus this morning, it's just a day to allow the Spirit to renew us and bring us back under his leadership. And as we have a time of invitation, maybe you just want to gather around front, just as a symbol of your commitment to Christ. God, you're leading, I'm following. Maybe you're here this morning and you've never placed your faith in Jesus Christ. Today will be a wonderful day for you to give your life to Jesus. For the first time to believe that Christ died in your place and he rose again 3 days later for you because he loves you, because you're valuable to him. And he wants you to have a new life, a different life, a good life, a life under his leadership. And maybe this morning, for the very first time, you need to repent of your sins, turn from your sins, and turn to God by faith. I'll be down front. I'd love to talk to you. Or you can go to one of these two crosses in the corner of this room. And there'll be someone at one of those crosses ready to talk with you today and help you today begin a relationship with Jesus. If you're watching online, you're going to see a number come on the screen. You can text that number, and we'll reach out to you and today help you begin a relationship with Jesus. But today, we want you to know the shepherd. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for time to be together to worship. Thank you for your word. You're good to us. You are a faithful shepherd. And for that person in this room who's never placed his faith or her faith in Jesus, I pray that person would come this morning and trust you. And for those of us who are followers of yours, follow your leadership well. To not treat you like a buffet of options, but to recognize that you are the God of all creation and Lord of our lives who is worthy of our all. And so, Father, in these moments, we know that you're speaking to us. Help us to obey your voice as you lead us. And ask it in Jesus' name, amen. You rise to your feet as we have a time of invitation together. You come now as the Spirit of God leads you. Just as